worried that if they make an unconditional commitment to control the yields on Italian and Spanish sovereign debt, then the politicians will say we won and go home. And that'll take away the energy and pressure and urgency behind the reform process. So this is a guess, Carlo. My best guess is they are going to intervene, but they're not going to say they're going to do it to keep the pressure on. And that's a dangerous game. But that's the game I think we're playing right now. And if it works, and the reforms work, and all of this happens, the Eurozone core stays together. But this is the epicenter of that risk. I'm going to change gears on you again and talk about the structure of the American economy. What I'm trying to do here is tell you that this is, in multiple dimensions, a very complex environment that we're living in, where changes in the structure of the environment that we're operating in, namely the global environment, are so fast that markets, even though they're pretty good, aren't keeping up. I sometimes tell people, you know, the labor markets, when I look around the world, in advanced and developing, and many developing countries, look like they're permanently out of equilibrium. That is, they're permanently in a state of trying to sort of chase the movement of economic activity around the global economy. You wouldn't have to argue very hard to make that case. America's unemployment rate, you know, for whatever reasons you think is, you know, is stuck at 8.5% and has been up at 9. Unemployment's pretty high in a good chunk of Europe. The Spanish youth are unemployed at the rate of between 30 and 40%. There's huge youth unemployment problems in the Middle East, in China. You know, they're chasing a rapidly moving economy. I mean, I think the image that is, you know, useful is that markets are always trying to sort of close these gaps, but sometimes things move so fast that they just can't keep up, at least when it comes to structural change. So what my research associate and I did, just to take a case, the American case, was to go back 18 years to 1990 before the crisis of 2008 and ask industry by industry and sector by sector, where did we generate growth, meaning value added, to use the economist's technical term, I apologize, and where do we generate employment? And we divided the economy into the tradable sector and the non-tradable sector. And since that may not be familiar terminology to all of you, let me say what it is. The tradable sector is the goods and services that in principle can be supplied, even if they're not, okay? In principle, it can be produced in one country and consumed in another. Now, the big growing part of that, of course, and this is a moving target, is trade and services, which didn't used to be tradable and now are, a growing set of them. You know, medical diagnostics, you know, backroom business process outsourcing, IT servicing, a whole bunch of stuff is one of the high growth parts of the global economy, which is the tradable economy. And then the non-tradable part is huge in any economy. It's probably 65 to 70%. It's largely services, but it's goods and services that have to be produced in the country where they're consumed. It's construction, it's most of retail, it's most of government, it's most of healthcare. These are gigantic sectors, both in terms of resources consumed and employment. So we did this, dividing up the American economy, sector by sector, tradable, non-tradable, sometimes having to divide an industry. Full confession, the data aren't perfect, but the results are so dramatic, I think you'd have to muck around with the data a fair amount not to get a conclusion. And the startling thing, the thing that really got people's attention, is that in those 18 years, the American economy generated 27 million jobs. It's a lot of jobs, net. And 98% of them were in the non-tradable sector. The tradable sector of the American economy, which grew, you know, just fine. If you were looking at growth, you'd say, well, it's growing a little faster than the non-tradable side. Didn't produce any employment. And so, if you accept the two things I just said, which is these things grew, then what happened in the American economy is pretty easy to see at a kind of macro level. In the tradable sector, they generated a lot of value and no employment growth, so value added per person and incomes rose like a rocket. But incomes and value added per person are pretty closely correlated. They're not the same because the capital intensity of some industries is, they vary a little bit. On the tradable side, value increased and employment increased a lot, and so we used up most of the value On the non-tradable side, by increased employment, so value added per person didn't rise very much and incomes didn't grow very much. Now stand back from that and ask what happened. Okay? We generated in the employment in the places where income didn't rise, and we didn't generate employment in the sector where the incomes did rise. So it isn't very surprising that you see a version of what I showed you before about the income distribution. Now, if you look underneath this, what's happening is there's two powerful forces at loose in the world. One is labor-saving technology, usually associated with information technology, and the other is globalization. And it's hard to sort out which one's doing what at any point of time with the data that we normally have available. But to a first approximation, on the American tradable side, there were a bunch of services in the upper end of the manufacturing value-added chains, which are long and complicated globally, which did just fine. That's a place where we have what economists call a comparative advantage, not uniquely, like a lot of other countries. And that's where highly educated people work and get paid a lot, and they're happy as clams. They think the global economy's terrific. The lower value-added per person jobs in that part of the economy tended to drift offshore. They're someplace else. And that created a shortage of jobs in the middle to lower income range, or the same range with respect to education. And those people flowed across the boundary and competed, in this case successfully, miraculously successfully, in terms of unemployment, for the jobs on the non-tradable side until the whole engine stopped with the crisis. Now, people have different views of this, and the reason I wrote it wasn't to settle the issue, but was to make people think about it. Is that really a sustainable pattern of growth? Can you have an economy run indefinitely on no employment generated in the tradable sector? I'm not going to present you with, I mean, I have views on that, but the point is, this is a time in which the global economy and technology are having big effects on structure, on employment opportunities, as a portfolio that really matter to people. It's not just the aggregate measure unemployment, it's what you have in front of you to work with. If you think of yourself, as many young of you young people do, as citizens of the global economy, you know, I'll work wherever it's fun and it's growing and it's interesting and there's new challenges and new technology and social networks, that's fine. But you have to understand, there's a bunch of people who aren't sitting in this room who don't have that opportunity set, and they're facing a dramatically diminished set of range of employment opportunities that require some kind of thinking about the structure and probably intervention. Now, I mean, I'm not going to spend all afternoon on it. In the American case, we've underinvested in general. We've underinvested in infrastructure. We have huge skills gaps, so there's jobs that are available, you know, for which there's nobody who can fill them. We have educational deficits that are quite common around the world in advanced and developing countries. These are all things that may or may not solve all the problem, probably won't solve all the distributional problem, but are for sure targets that deserve attention. And you don't get at them and take them seriously unless you sort of see the world from a microeconomic point of view. This is the German case. So Germany went through a major set of reforms because in the year 2000, many of us in this room viewed Germany as the basket case of Europe in terms of productivity, employment, and competitiveness, and so did they. So they went after it under Chancellor Schroeder and the Social Democrats, and they made a whole bunch of changes, and the effect of it was they basically made the tradable sector a growth engine and an employment engine. Now, in order to do that, and this has lessons for Italy, they had to free up the labor markets. They had to make a different deal for labor because protection, safe social safety nets, no longer came from where you worked in that plant in that town. It came from rebuilt safety nets that had to do with individuals and families, right, and not companies and jobs, specific jobs. And they had a whole lot of other things like that to do, but the point, the maybe uniquely important thing about Germany was that labor, business, and government sat down and kind of worked this out. It wasn't easy. I did talk to Chancellor Schroeder, and he sort of somewhat shyly said, well, it did cost me my job, but it worked. So it isn't inevitable. If I'll just show you a little, this is value added per person. On the German side, there's a mass of data behind this, but I won't do it. The United States is also an outlier in having sort of run large trade or current account deficits. It's unique. It runs a current deficit with respect to everybody. I can't think of any exception. There's probably a small country somewhere where we don't have a current account deficit. And when you add that, the bilateral one with China's big, but that's an artifact of the way we keep trade data. We don't do it on a value-added basis. This doesn't have to be like this. Japan, Korea, and Germany are pretty advanced countries. And in the German case, they run a modest surplus with respect to China, and the others run big surpluses. So it isn't inevitable that an advanced country is going to end up with this kind of... Now, people disagree on, you know, how big and for how long can you run a current account deficit before you start to think maybe this isn't actually going to work forever. I'm on the side that it's a bad idea. But it's a debatable set of things. Briefly on China. China is entering the middle income transition. This is the point in the history of the development of a country in which the things that were major growth drivers on the tradable side of the economy, namely labor-intensive, process-oriented manufacturing and assembly, are no longer economic and move to earlier stage developing countries. And so you have to replace all that with something else. And the domestic economy gets bigger and is a more important engine of growth, domestic demand, and policies have to change with it. Now you might say, as I often do say, you know, people have been betting against China, you know, for 31 years now since the reforms in 1978 when growth actually started, and they've lost every year. Why start betting against them now? Well, this one's hard. And the one way to see that it's hard is if you look at developing countries who enter the middle income transition. Now these are at, you know, different times. At high speed, most of them stop or slow down dramatically. The two exceptions on this graph, and they slowed down later, but that was for a different reason. It was called the 97-98 currency crisis, were Taiwan, now China, and South Korea. If you actually ask what are all the cases of high-speed middle-income transitions, there's only five. Two of them are city-states, and the others are Japan, Korea, and the Taiwanese economy. Now, what I mean, we could spend some time talking about this if you want. I know a fair amount about it because we were part of inputs that resulted in the 12th five-year plan, which is the game plan for getting started through the middle income transition in China. That's what that book was that I showed you at the start. but these are huge changes. There's Justin Lin at the World Bank, who's a Chinese economist actually, says that there's a minimum of 85 million jobs about to exit from China in this labor-intensive tradable side. That, by the way, is a gigantic opportunity for the rest of the developing world. I mean, most people don't think of it that way. They think, well, maybe we could get them back in Europe or America. That's nonsense. They're not coming anywhere near us. They're, you know, we can't operate at, you know, value-added levels there, and they're catching up with us. But these are some of the major structural changes. What I need to tell you is that Chinese authorities, and there's a very talented group of people in there doing this, understand this completely. The risks in this really aren't failing to understand, however complex, the dynamics of this set of transitions. The risks are all implementation, is actually doing the things you need to get done in order to facilitate this. So the government has to withdraw and let the market decide more. It has to encourage innovation. It has to invest in human capital. It has to stop targeting specific industries. It has to let the industries that are going to die, die, and the employment go away in those sectors and be replaced somewhere else. This is scary stuff. I mean, China has 1.3 billion people. 50% of them are still in agriculture. And the traditional route out of agriculture into the modern economy was through the export sector. Initially, young women going to work for 2 or 3 years and then going back with a larger stake. And that's not true anymore. I mean, now they actually move to the cities. So if you think the employment engine's going to stall, then you start to think, well, what are the consequences of that? And the answer is we got this flow of humanity coming into the cities looking for these employment opportunities. That is the growth model. And it's a large flow. It's, you know, it's on the order of 15 million people a year. You know, in 5 years, no, four, all of Italy and China moves to the city. Or the way I sometimes did describe it in the book, China has to build Los Angeles every year to accommodate this, essentially. Now, there's an answer to that, and that is that is not going to be the low-skilled, you know, entry point into the modern economy. The low-skilled entry point is going to be the service sectors in the cities, which are growing, and not necessarily the export sector, which is going to be busy moving up the value-added chain and will require different education and skill to do it. But the point of all that is not to convince you that you will understand in the next 45 minutes what all the moving parts are, but they do, and they're complicated, and there's a way to do it. It's not, there's no dead ends in this. I suspect they'll get the main resistance not from the export sector, but from the state-owned enterprises. The state-owned enterprises in China have reformed. They're much more competitive than they used to be, but they account for more than half the net fixed assets in the economy. They make a lot of money, and they're really powerful. And if they want to resist what the Chinese call marketization of the economy, they've got the resources to do it. So that is a question mark. The other reason the state-owned enterprises are important, and I'm not suggesting the Chinese should or will privatize them, but there's one thing they need to stop doing, and that is investing in low-return stuff. Right? China is an economy whose growth engines were investment, very high levels of investment. I told you that about a third would do. China's investment level is on the order of 45% of GDP, almost half. And when they were running a big surplus, the savings rate was 55% of GDP. And that's just never happened before. So it's an outlier in these dimensions. It's a big, powerful growth engine, and it works as long as the investments are high return, private and social. So this includes public sector investment. If those returns go down because they're just investing on autopilot because they have the resources, then two things happen. One, it's a trap, right? You know, you get growth from investment because it generates a whole lot of output and more demand in the future. Those are called intertemporal multipliers. But if they stop existing, then you just stop at some point. Or you have to keep investing more and more in order to keep it going. The other thing is that low return investment should be household income, turning into household consumption, driving the growth and the composition structural change in the economy. Now I think I've said enough for you so that you know kind of A, it's complicated, and B, they get it. And that they may get resistance. We're just all watching to see if they pull this off. These are just bits and pieces on the Chinese side. This one I find interesting, so I'll just say a word about it. This data is not very good, but this was somebody's attempt for the OECD countries, the high-income countries, to estimate the fraction of national income that goes to labor. And that number rose significantly from, I'm sorry, the stuff on the this got garbled, so don't try to read that. But it basically, this is the post-war period, so it rose and then it started to go down. This is the globalization effect. That is, the returns in the global economy, the return to capital, meaning the total return, not the return as a rate, including high-end human capital, is rising. So if you talk to American labor economists, they'll say, what's going on in the labor market? And they'll say, the rate of return to capital human capital is rising. That's absolutely right. But that can happen for two reasons. The numerator can go up, or the denominator can go down, or both. And for lots of people, you know, it's actually the two. The denominator went down because of the globalization effect. I'm almost done, but I don't want to leave before drawing your attention again to income distribution issues. This is three measures of income distribution for a wide range of countries, and you don't have time to read all this, but this is the standard Gini coefficient, which many people understand, but not everybody. This is the one I tend to prefer. It's the ratio of the average income of the top 20% to the bottom 20%. So it's a kind of measure of the spread. But it's not the top 1% where people get quite exercised, you know, but I just find it hard to spend all of my time discussing income distribution by asking whether Steve Jobs or Bill Gates, you know, or Ray Dalio deserve to make that much money. I don't think it's the main issue. The main issue is broader than that. This is the same thing for 10%. Now here you have the United States, and that ratio is 8.4 times. Meaning the top 20% get 8.4 times the income of the bottom 20%. In Germany, that number is 4.3. All I'm saying, now, these are economies that are advanced economies, like the one we're standing in, with the same technological and global forces operating on them. And you asked yourself, if you really believe that these are market urban outcomes, then how on earth can you get a difference of a factor of 2 in the way income gets distributed? The point I'm trying to make is that even in this dimension, the sort of social overlay and values that affect the way income is distributed are simply not present in economic models at the present time. And the best evidence for it is just the enormous range here. By the way, China's not in that great shape either. China has a huge income distribution problem and related social tensions. That's part of the operating 12-5-year plan. There are an estimated 90,000 demonstrations, many of them violent, in China, having to do with income distribution, local corruption, and other stuff. I won't spend any time on this. If you're interested, these are the PISA scores from the OECD, and if you stare at this long enough, what you'll discover is that the advanced countries are slipping relative to the best of the developing countries, and especially in math and science. So, again, I won't. Let me conclude with just a couple of thoughts on markets and the role of the state. I just wrote a couple of things where I started to try to think about these things, and it occurred to me that, I mean, I had thought before and say in the book, that the distributional implications of globalization for much of the post-war period were pretty benign. Europe grew very quickly and recovered from the war. America did fine. Canada did fine. The developing countries, with faltering starts, started growing like a weed. It's hard to find a cloud in that picture up until relatively recently, say the last 10 or 15 years. But that was an accident. That's not what markets are meant to do, right? Markets do efficiency, innovation, and growth well, and they're relatively poorly adapted to dealing with equity, stability, and sustainability issues for a lot of different reasons. One, we make mistakes and don't identify sustainability problems. Two, there's externalities associated with sustainability. Three, on stability, we have an astonishing number of economic structures that are essentially networks. There's global supply chain networks, there's financial networks. Networks are sometimes built by a single entity and optimized in terms of efficiency and resilience and a whole bunch of other things, but they're more often built in a decentralized fashion by people optimizing locally in their part. And that, I think, gives us A, lack of resilience, and B, a question mark, or more than a question mark, with respect to stability. So you all know about the financial markets, where essentially, those very complicated stories associated with this, a bunch of people were tinkering with increasingly complex products that nobody understood, optimizing at the margin, thinking the whole structure was stable when it wasn't, when that pattern of activity made it unstable. When the tsunami came in Japan, a whole lot of supply chains, including a good chunk of the automobile supply chain globally, came to a screeching halt. And so the people in those supply chains realized, for the first time, really, that these supply chains were wound too tight in terms of efficiency. Efficiency and winding tightly is the enemy of resilience, because the way to be efficient is to get rid of redundancy, get rid of the second channel, right? It's just cost until you need it, right? And so this kind of trade-off is fairly easy to understand, but it isn't made well in a decentralized market structure, and so on. And finally, and this is more controversial, I think we have attended to the balance sheet of countries, the state's balance sheet. One of the things you learn from the Chinese experience, where the balance sheet is of the public sector is gigantic, is it has real advantages, and there are several. One is you have resources if you have a shock, right? A second one is that if the return to capital goes up and you own a lot of capital, you can redistribute that income because you get the income and use it to fund social services and not ask people to pay so much in taxes. Third, most countries have to invest heavily on the public sector side in technology, and most of us invest in it and get none of the return unless you count, you know, the growth effect as a return, but nothing directly that you would call government income. That may not be the best way to do business in the future. Again, I'm not trying to tell you that I or anybody else has an answer, but I don't even think we've raised the question of what the state's balance sheet should look like. In fact, the state balance sheet in most advanced countries consists of a whole bunch of liabilities that you saw before and no assets whatsoever, other than the presumed ability to tax either the current or future generations to pay for, you know, the servicing of the debt associated or the things associated with those liabilities. And I think that's a mistake. Final thought. Several decades ago, there was a young guy who wrote about the subject called signaling. That would be me. And signaling models, I don't know how many of you in this room have sort of studied them or read them. I know Carlo has because Joe made him do it. But the signaling models have an important structural characteristic, and that is that expectations or beliefs about the world are endogenous to the model. That is, the equilibrium is defined by people making appropriate decisions based on what they believe about the world. But those decisions are affected by those beliefs. So in the labor market, people think if you have an education from a fancy university like Kafaskari, then you've got a better chance of being a highly productive, you know, high potential person, and that'll be reflected in the offers you get and the salaries, right? Now, embedded in that model is a set of beliefs. Employers believe that, you believe it, you bust your butts and invest in this education, you go on the job markets, and if the thing's in equilibrium, it's true. Lots of times it's not in equilibrium. There's a whole lot of kids in China who have a fancy looking education that aren't getting the fancy jobs they expected to. The point is that expectations are embedded in the model, and it's in equilibrium when the expectations are consistent over time with the experience of participants in the market. And those models have multiple equilibria. It's inherent in the structure in many of them that they have multiple equilibria. And so then when you start to think about, you know, the number of places in our economy, including ones that have developed a fair amount of instability, that have this characteristic, this underlying structural characteristic, that expectations drive prices and a lot of other stuff, behavior, it's possible we've got situations in which we have multiple equilibria. Now, I don't have time, you know, to go through a whole bunch of examples. I believe that financial markets go off on tangents for periods of time. Lots of other people believe this too, and the value investing anchor brings them back. I believe that in the internet bubble, there was no data to bring it back, so you had to believe. So it went on for longer and was a bit more destructive until the data came in and said, you know what, this, you know, business model is nonsense. There is no revenue and there is no profit, and then it all came crashing back down. The problem in the current situation is that the anchor, the thing that brings it back, either is or isn't the public sector. And that's why, from an investment point of view, We are living in a world, it's a really tough world, because we're living in a world in which we sometimes describe it as two scenarios. It's actually multiple equilibria, including in the Italian case, right? There's expectations about what's going to happen, and depending on policy intervention, this one could go one way or the other, and the only thing that makes people different is the probabilities they assign to those two paths. But for sure, if the yield on Italian sovereign debt goes to 9% and stays there, something different is going to happen than if, you know, there's a kind of intervention and the reforms start to struggle through and whatnot. And they're really different outcomes. I mean, one's a huge downturn, spreads all over Europe because the Eurozone core comes apart, and the other one is a struggle back to, you know, a difficult, you know, slow but better environment in terms of growth and employment. If you look at this from an investment point of view, which I sometimes do to try to stay grounded and say, well, I'll take my probabilities. You know, there's 60% that it'll all work and 40% that it won't. And each one of those has a distribution that looks something like this. If you take an average of those distributions, I mean, you can probably do most of this in your head, you get bimodal distributions. Most of the people, sophisticated investors in the world, realize that there's two equilibrium outcomes, and they're investing or trying to figure out a way to invest in a bimodal, you know, distribution outcome. Now, one way to do that is to bet on the good outcome and try to find a way that isn't ridiculously expensive to hedge the tail risk on the lower one. But tail risk is not quite the right concept. We used to think in terms of fat tails, and you really have to take care of the, well, from your point of view, this tail. But actually, bimodal distributions are even harder investment environments. Last comment, and then I'll shut up. I believe we have huge sustainability issues, which lots of us, including Carlo and I just had a discussion, would define not just as natural resources in the environment, but more broadly in terms of equity and stability and social cohesion and other things. But the natural resource part is important. I don't have a whole lot to say about this except that, because I've been thinking about it for a long time, but that doesn't distinguish me from several tens of thousands of other people. What I will tell you is that for the first time in Asia, in China, and it started in India, they have realized that the sustainability issues, which they're used to, because they're used to structural change and whether this is all going to come to a screeching stop, on the natural resource and environment front, they've realized that they're big enough, potentially, not now, but potentially, to stop their own growth process, right? So what we all think of as a sort of difficult global set of challenges, increasingly in Asia, is just a long-term growth issue for them. So specifically in China, if you go and listen very carefully now, he'll talk about altering the lifestyles. What does that mean? Mm-hmm. Well, what it means is the old growth model won't work. It just won't scale to where we want to be. I mean, this is a country whose economy will eventually be 20% of the global economy, and a global economy that's huge. So they're right about that. So what they're starting to do, and it is embedded in the 12 five-year plan, is to try to invent a different growth model, meaning an altered growth pattern, to use their term, that economizes on water, on natural resources. Nobody knows how to do it, but it's a completely different incentive structure than we've had before, because in earlier stages when they were small and we were kind of fragmented and not sure we took all this stuff terribly seriously, you know, there wasn't anybody who was the natural kind of leader. I'll make a slightly daring prediction. I believe there's a reasonably good chance that Asia will become the sort of driving force in a good chunk of the implementation of sustainability measures in the future. And the basic reason is it's in their self-interest. They can't get to mid-century on the growth model they're on now. I mean, the environmental problems are already huge. So that's where we're going. I love this, and I'll stop with this. I don't know anything anywhere near as much as Carlo does about climate change and all the things that go with it, but I did spend some time thinking about it with respect to the developing countries. But I love this graph. I'm sorry, Harold, but we're having to reduce our carbon footprint. Anyway, there's a little bit more here, but I'll just stop by saying I just read a really quite good book. I had a colleague at Stanford named Bert Richter. He's a Nobel laureate in high energy physics. He ran the Stanford Linear Accelerator, which is the kind of mini version of CERN, I guess. And he just wrote quite a good book called Beyond Smoke and Mirrors. So if you want a kind of layman's framing of energy availability and stuff like that and climate change issues and which options look promising and which don't, I think Bert's book is really quite good. Anyway, thank you for listening to me.